Hello, beloved ones. I am Matt Kahn, and as always, I welcome you with love. Welcome to the first ever all-access Q&A video, where over the past year, I have had the pleasure of guiding so many of you throughout our all-access membership, and it's a place where you get to ask your life's most burning questions. And so we created this Q&A series so I can be able to interact with so many of you and be able to answer your questions more directly in between calls. So without further ado, let's see what question number one has in store. And again, these are questions that have been gathered from the All Access community, questions I've never seen before. So we will be discovering together each question, and I'll be channeling from the universe what each question inspires, not only for the person asking the question, but for you at home watching. So it's very exciting. So let's go for it. Okay. Question number one. I've heard you say twice that you were integrating something and therefore couldn't write with joy, and the other time you needed time to integrate. How do you know that you're integrating? That's a great question. Is it when I feel off, exhausted, emotional, have a hard time communicating clearly? I feel the need out of curiosity to know whether I'm integrating or healing, but perhaps it's just the same thing. There's just so many interesting sensations I feel inside me that it makes me want to understand it better. Well, what a great question. Thanks so much for asking. So I would say that when we are healing, healing is often a moment of release. So healing can either be the feeling of some of you or a part of you is dying off, or I can feel as if you're giving birth to a new version of yourself. So healing to me is either something is being born within me or something is fading away or dying off in me. Integration is actually the period that follows either some form of rebirth or death. Integration is kind of like if you were to give birth or to experience the death of a version of you. Integration would be that space that follows such a big upheaval. And it would be when the dust is settling and you would feel into yourself and say, I really just need to rest today. I really don't feel like if I have the energy to get a lot of things done. Like when I was a kid and I would energetically have days where I needed to integrate and it wasn't something I knew how to put into words. And so I learned as a kid to tell my parents I didn't feel well because that was the only way I could avoid going to school. And so for a lot of us, integration is when we're having a low energy day. Maybe integration feels like a low emotional day. Feels like a day where you just would rather twist the blinds, stay in bed, and nurture yourself. And so when the questioner asked, is it when I feel off, exhausted, emotional, and have a hard time communicating clearly, those can actually be very clear signs that integration is underway. It could also be a sign that you're experiencing the beginnings, the buildup of a greater release, whether it's going to be a rebirth or the dying off of an old part of self. So I would just say that integration, whether occurring on an emotional or energetic level, and of course it could also occur physically, right after we work out, after we exhaust ourselves, and the next day we find ourselves a little sore. And so we have to give ourselves the appropriate amount of rest to let our muscles rebuild, to allow our body to rejuvenate. That in itself is what integration really means, whether physically, emotionally, or energetically, is knowing when I need to give myself rest in honor of the processes I'm in. And the thing that I think is interesting to focus on is learning the difference between when I'm really integrating and when I really need time to be in my own space, to not communicate as openly, and to really go inward and rest and recharge. Can we know the difference between authentic needs for integration and a way of checking out, shutting down, or avoiding life when it seems it's most precarious, uncertain, or when we're surrounded by circumstances that we might be afraid to face. And so I think the very interesting thing about integration is, when is integration authentic and when is it being used as a way of avoiding a checking out? And for each and every one of us, it's really going to be quite different. And so I think whenever we feel the need to rest and recharge, of course, always give yourself that. But I think it's just kind of becoming aware of, is this spontaneously arising? Is it following some big emotional releases or rebirths? Or perhaps it's always conveniently showing up when life is its most precarious and uncertain. And is this need for integration a way for my spiritual ego to check out and to avoid and to bypass? And again, it's not an answer that you maybe are going to get instantaneously. It's just something to be aware of. Am I actually resting and giving myself the nourishment that I need? Or am I just shutting down and checking out? And maybe one way that can help you know the difference is, when you're integrating, what do you do with your time? Are you feeding yourself healthy nutrition? Are you hydrating yourself? Are you giving yourself stillness and silence? Because in stillness and silence, your awareness doesn't have as much sensation to process emotionally or mentally or energetically. And so when we are treating an integration day, even if we're at home, kind of like a day at the spa, that's when we're really nourishing ourselves. And when, if you spend time at home, but you're just kind of binge watching Netflix shows, or you're just kind of checking out on social media, or just kind of lost in online gaming, or anything really repetitive that includes stimulation and even overexposure to EMF frequencies, that's kind of a telltale sign that we're using integration as an excuse to check out. And when we spend days integrating in those type of repetitive processes, it actually, instead of rejuvenating us, actually breaks down our life force energy even more, which is why some of us can rest and rest and rest and not actually feel recharged. And for some of us, an integration day isn't really about doing nothing. Sometimes going for a walk can recharge you, where lying down for long periods of time may be appropriate in other times. So we really have to play with this and be intuitives and detectives in our own inner mystery, and really look at a few really interesting key points. Am I really taking this time to integrate, or is integration being used as an excuse to check out and feed repetitive patterns of isolation? Am I emotionally eating? Am I overindulging? Am I getting lost in social media, lost in video, online gaming, lost in binge watching? Or am I giving myself time for stillness, for silence, maybe some writing in my journal of inner self-reflection, maybe some creative self-expression? Am I also making time to take a little bit of a walk, even if it has to be a slow walk? Am I giving myself a chance to really make integration a chance to find greater balance? And of course, to ensure that the time I take to nurture myself and to bring balance into my life is also not being used to check out from the details and demands of everyday life. And so as we integrate in the fifth dimension, whereas in the third dimension, it used to be I do, and then I spend time to be, and we go back and forth between the polarity of being and doing. In the fifth dimension, being and doing actually converge, and what we learn is we learn to live an integrative lifestyle, to where all of your doing can actually emanate from the presence of your being. And in that, you find yourself able to rejuvenate and recharge while you're taking action, not exhausting yourself in action and needing to check out for a few days to replenish yourself. And so really, when we think of integration is the time we take to nurture and nourish ourselves for all the energy we expend and all the light we bring to the planet. But as we enter and integrate into the fifth dimension, we become ever integrated beings, which means all doing comes from an inspired state of being, and we rejuvenate and recharge while we expend energy. And that allows being and doing to come together and to be what's called a closed circuit of energy within you. And once the energy within you has become a closed circuit, then you are nourished by your connection to spirit fully, and everyone outside of you can be seen as just journeying on their own unique experience. And it's at that point where you find spiritually a state of detachment, where other people's experiences are really reflecting to you where they're at in their journey, and it doesn't have to be taken personally about you in any way. Because the reason we take things personally while we're integrating towards this closed circuit of energy is because we're relying on other people for the nourishment we haven't fully found in ourselves. So it's important to integrate and to cultivate the consciousness that closes this circuit and creates this continuous loop of being and doing as one. And it's from that place where we find ourselves being sovereign, connected to spirit without any sense of disconnection, and nourished by our connection to the light, and nourished by the light we shine, and allowing everyone else's contribution to us to just simply be extra. And we get there by taking time to rest. But again, my intuition wants to really just highlight, let's look at, and let's start to look at when I really do need rest. And when I do need rest, am I giving myself time to rest or do things that recharge me, instead of checking out into more overstimulation or patterns that are just going to keep me depleted? And so it's very different when the ego just wants a day off. And there's nothing wrong with that. But an ego's day off is very different than the soul's desire to fully integrate and recharge its life force energy. And each and every one of us are intuitive enough to start to notice this. We just have to start looking at it from the right lens. When is the time that I really need the rest that I require? When perhaps am I using integration as a chance to check out? When am I maybe using integration as an excuse to not speak boldly to the people I'm afraid of being rejected by, or the people in my life that would never understand me not wanting to be social unless it had to do with something I'm going through emotionally or energetically? When am I using integration authentically, and when am I using it divisively? And again, these are the type of questions where we plant the seeds, and it just allows us to take a deeper look over time. Sometimes I give you answers and it creates that aha immediately, and maybe you're having some even through this first question and answer. But this is the type of insight where we plant the seeds, and over time it gradually gives you greater awareness. Because one of the telltale signs of a truly integrated being is being intuitive enough, wise enough, and insightful enough to be able to honor your ego, to love your ego, but to also recognize the games it plays, to know how it manipulates, and when it's trying to create a narrative to move you in an unconscious direction. We don't have to fight the ego. But at a certain point, we're certainly not here to indulge it. And by honoring it, but not indulging it, it is one of the most loving acts you can do for the ego, that you are walking home within your own heart. Thank you very much for asking that question and all the insights it just inspired. Question number two. When I tap into feeling one with the universe, after the initial peace I feel, I develop a deep sense of loneliness. It's uncomfortable, knowing that all aspects of being are just source, splintered into an infinite array of possibilities, and yet still just source. Can you tell me why, when I really start to think about it too much, and I really start to enter the state of being consciousness, does oneness feel so lonely? Well, what's interesting is that when everything is just pure source, there isn't that part of us to feel lonely about it. So what happens is when we start to glimpse into oneness, the ego that is still acting and operating from states of unconsciousness interprets oneness as if the ego is the only one in existence. So it's as if the ego takes on a personification of oneness. And it's as if oneness thinks of itself as being lonely, like I'm the only oneness in existence. There's no oneness but me. But in true oneness, there isn't even that voice or sense of separation. So when we start to glimpse oneness, the ego that has not been dissolved by the full revelation of oneness starts to sense loneliness, which is actually a sign that your ego is starting to slowly let go of its grip of control. Every time the ego lets go of its grip of control, it starts to feel either lonely, ashamed of itself, defeated, or sad, or like it's experiencing a loss. And the loss it's experiencing is the death of itself, the death of its attachment to itself as a character. And so the loneliness we feel, we can say to our hearts, I understand that I'm starting to open up to oneness, but my ego is internalizing oneness as if oneness means one eternal ego. But in the true state of oneness, there is no ego coming or going. So therefore, there is no one to be lonely, no thing to be lonely about. For loneliness is either the pining for something, someone, or processing the loss of something or someone. But in the true revelation of oneness, there is no thing, there is no one. Therefore, who is there to be lonely? And what is there to be lonely about? And even as I channel these words, you can feel a deeper beingness and solitude arising within you. Just feel that for a moment before I go on to something about the question I want to point out. Can you feel this? In true oneness, there is no one to be lonely and no thing to be lonely about. And when part of your ego still exists, oneness becomes something that we can still overthink. And it's innocent and it's okay. And something else I want to point out in the question, and again, because all the questions give us little breadcrumbs to deeper insights. When I tap into feeling one with the universe, what I think will help a lot of us is that we may interpret one with the universe as a feeling, but it's only because there's a separate sense of self, an ego, that uses feeling and thought to orient itself in time and space. But what if one with the universe is not actually a feeling? What if one with the universe isn't actually a thought? And if one with the universe isn't actually a feeling or thought, there is no one here to be lonely and no thing to be lonely about. Because those would only be thoughts and feelings, interpreting ideas about oneness, but not oneness itself. I mean, the loneliness is stirred by the thoughts and feelings, the ideas about oneness, the waves. But studying the waves doesn't tell you anything about the stillness of the ocean. So oneness is not a thought. Oneness is not captured in a feeling. Those are just ways we interpret our ideas about it. That's just how we go into the ocean and move our hands and feet to splash around and make waves. But we don't need to go into the ocean to make waves. we go into the ocean to remember ourselves. And when there is no thought that can glimpse oneness, no feeling that can interpret its immensity, and when it's okay that there's no one to be lonely and no thing to be lonely about, that's when you allow the ocean to carry you out into your deepest journey, in a journey where only the ocean is moving itself. You are the ocean, not any wave coming or going. And if a wave coming or going is a thought or a feeling, it's wonderful. And yet, no wave can ever be big enough to ever endanger or drown the ocean. So let waves come and go. It just has nothing to do with the oneness waking up in you. And so to answer the question, when you're feeling the way you're feeling, it helps us learn the feelings we associate with oneness are not meant to remain, because oneness is not a feeling. If those feelings were to remain, you would be fooled into thinking oneness is a feeling, and then you'd be trying to help other people get to that feeling and thinking that when you don't feel that feeling, you somehow moved out of oneness. If oneness is a feeling, then whenever you're not feeling that way, you think you've fallen from grace. And if oneness can be encapsulated in a thought, you'll feel lonely whenever separate from that thought, as if it's a relationship you're trying to maintain. But when oneness is not a thought or feeling, there is no one to be lonely and no thing to be lonely about. And it's the space where the cycle of birth and death stops, and the beingness of your presence simply is. Not even the voice inside to say, I'm present now. Because who is here to say that, and who are they speaking to? There's not even a sense of separation for that to be acknowledged, because there would have to be something other than present for that to be something different or unique. And even if you thought present was different than being in your mind, that's all the play. That's all the spiritual play prior to the awakening of oneness. In true oneness, there is no mind. Or there's one mind, and it's called the heart of existence. Thoughts and feelings are simply waves coming and going. There's no one to be lonely and no thing to be lonely about. And any part of your ego that remains goes through the detox process of needing stimulation and coping devices. And so it's like an addict going through rehab. That's what lonely, loss, heartbreak, and all the stages of grief represent in the awakening journey. The ego being detoxified from its addiction to stimulation and its attachment to coping devices. Because when you enter the kingdom of heaven, if heaven on earth were to dawn right now, there'd be nothing left to cope with. And for an incredible percentage of the world to one day wake up with nothing to cope with would actually be horrific. Not a dream come true. It sounds like a dream come true because you're imagining peace with your coping devices. So imagine if the universe said, you can have a life of infinite peace, but you'll have nothing to cope with, and you'll have no more devices to cope with. Would you hand them over? And when you start to really glimpse that insight that I'm channeling, you can realize how much of your life is used by your ego to cope with life and to entertain itself by creating patterns that it will then question and try to escape from. And that's what the ego basically does. It creates patterns that it will have to escape from. And it creates a loop of digging itself holes, throwing itself in holes so it has a need to be rescued. Or something to rescue itself from. And then oneness arises. And life says you wanted peace. You wanted connection. You wanted surrender. But you'll have nothing to cope with if you enter this domain. So please hand over all of your patterns and coping devices and find the freedom that you truly seek. And for people that have been initiated spiritually, and I could speak from my own experience, it was a welcome pleasure to hand over all my coping devices and all my hiding spots. But for a certain percentage of the world, peace sounds wonderful as long as we can keep the coping mechanisms in addictive patterns. For most people, peace on earth with your coping devices and addictive patterns is called vacation. And for most people, vacation turns out to be a reflection of how they experience their life at work or their home life. But if you truly want peace, if you truly want presence, if you truly want liberation, you will be going through a process where as you glimpse and glimpse oneness, you will be surrendered of all your coping devices, addictive patterns, and tendencies. And it will happen gradually so that you're not intimidated by it. And if you start to fight it, the universe will give you your patterns back and say, we will return. But you are here because you are ready to take a bigger step in this. And I'm simply offering the invitation. And so let's feel into this. In order to live a life of eternal connection, effortless presence, true solitude and peace, all of your coping devices and addictive patterns will be handed over. And that will happen when you're ready. You could try to do it faster than you're ready to do it, but the universe, thankfully, is more graceful and too smart for that. You could try to give it over too quickly, and the universe will smile and said, we, the universe, created you to give it over far slower. So we'll hand it right back until you're ready. And so the loneliness, the apathy, the exhaustion, the grief, the guilt, the shame, is layer by layer your ego learning how to cope or live without anything to cope with, without any addictive pattern to hide behind, while you simultaneously are being initiated into a remembrance of oneness, where there's no one here to be lonely and no thing to be lonely about. And if your life had no need for coping and no addictive pattern that we pretend is stress relief, what would you do with all that time? Well, like every enlightened master, you offer it to service for those who are suffering, while also spending time building upon the virtue of your deepest excitement. And even if you don't quite know what your excitement is right now, it just means you're still in the process of being reborn, getting to know what it's like for there to be no one to be lonely and no thing to be lonely about. And that's true whether you're surrounded by loved ones or the last one standing in your family of origin. Again, you can hear the words, but you can feel the energy so palpably. And thank you so much for asking such an incredible question and inspiring such an immense transmission. Thank you. Next question. It would be great if you and Joy could do a course or a podcast about the essence of embodied spirituality. I'm not sure I'm living it fully, and that is something that I would like to experience. This is a very funny question. And it's a very funny question because Joy and I have been planning a podcast, and the focus actually is embodied spirituality. That's not the title of it. I don't want to give the title away right now because we're still working on it. But this question, as all questions are quite intuitive. So to answer this question, Joy and I have been talking about doing a podcast, and the focus would be on spiritual embodiment, but we want to offer it with a theme that allows us both to show our personalities and give you a bird's eye look into our lives, and for us to do it with some humor. So it's going to be a beautiful balance of humor and, of course, tremendous profound insight, the balance of the masculine and feminine, and of course, all to help you embody your spirituality so that waking up can always be accompanied by growing up. And that's important for all of us. In all of us, there are parts that have grown up, and there are parts that are waking up. There are also parts that have woken up, and there are parts that are still growing up. And it's humbling when we can fully see that there are those four quadrants in me. Part of me has grown up. Part of me has woken up. Part of me is still growing up. And part of me is still waking up. And when we can accept those four aspects within ourselves, that's when we can be honest with ourselves. And we can make choices that give us what we need, not always assuming that what we want and what we need are one and the same. So just feel in your heart how humbling and nourishing it can be to say, there's part of me that has woken up. There's part of me that have grown up. There's a part that is growing up, and there's a part that is still waking up. And I accept that about myself. And I love myself and accept myself fully and completely. I love and accept the part that has grown up. I love and accept the part that has woken up. I love and accept the part that is still growing up. And I love and accept the part that is still waking up. Feel that. So beautiful. Okay, next question. Occasionally when asleep, I awake out of breath, usually associated with a nightmare of being trapped in a confined space or underwater. Is this related to a past trauma or pain that is being released, or is my ego trying to take charge by waking me up? Usually I have to get up and start work on some project for an hour or so before I can get back to sleep. Well, I don't necessarily think it's your ego trying to take charge by waking you up. I get that you're processing experiences from a past life. When I tune into this specific one, I wouldn't necessarily always say that, but from my intuition, I feel the frequency of this specific question. And so for this specific questioner, being trapped or confined in a confined space or underwater feels like a past life memory. So what I would say for anyone, if you wake up from a dream and you feel like it could be a past life memory, you can just say, I accept that I just experienced what might be a past life memory, and I allow anything that needs to be remembered, processed, and healed about that past life to be remembered, healed, and processed now. And there's a lot of people that assume if you say something like that, it's going to bring about a super intense experience, and it may not be the case at all. Sometimes when you invite in fullness the revelation, it actually just gives it permission to drift away and integrate instantly. And so what's more true about the universe, even though, again, this is just an aside about the question, because obviously my intuition is just sensing that this is something we all need to know as well, is that when you invite the fullness of experience, your ego will assume that means, oh God, it's about to get worse, right? If I invited the worst emotions to arise within me, that means I'm about to be toppled by the biggest emotional wave. But in truth, based on the law of polarity, if I invite the immensity of what needs to be resolved, what I actually invite is the immensity of resolution. Somebody said it again. My lips weren't quite cooperating with me right there. So if I invite the immensity of resolution to be revealed, what is often revealed is simply the immensity of resolution. So if I wake up from a dream and I sense that I was drowning or being chased, and I say to myself, whatever needs to be resolved about this, please show yourself and may you be healed. Some people would think that that's inviting greater havoc into their life. But what you're actually inviting is the resolution of it. And so the assumption is, oh, I don't want to say that because I'm going to really feel unsafe if I say that. But actually, if you say that, you're giving the universe permission to bring you into better resolution and safety around the subject. So if you ever wake up from a dream and you're not sure what you're processing, sometimes I can feel the frequency and go, oh, you're processing the collective or you're processing a past life. This particular question is a past life process. But either way, you can say to yourself, whether I'm processing the collective or a past life, whatever needs to be felt, remembered, and known for its highest and deepest healing, please reveal yourself for its highest resolution now. And all the universe hears is you're ready for resolution. And so by and large, what you're going to feel is not the reenactment of pain, not the remembrance of agony, but the resolution that those lifetimes never remembered having. And that's why the more we move towards our experiences, the more resolution we have within our experiences. And that's why when you're feeling afraid to feel or afraid to face yourself, it's the turning away that fear convinces you to do that keeps you in a state of fear. And that's why fear is here to be honored. But what fear tells you and tries to convince you of is an illusion. Because fear's job is to keep you in a state of fear until you outgrow that vibration. And so when you turn towards a feeling and fear says, no, that's going to make it more scary, please remember, beloved ones, it's only going to be scary for the fear that's losing its grip of control over you. And once fear has lost its grip of control over you, then fear bows to you and says, you've learned. I was a double agent created by consciousness. You've graduated past this grade level. I will leave you now. And then fear transforms into its highest frequency, which is courage. So you are transforming fear into courage by learning to lean into your experiences instead of listen to the illusory words that pretend to keep you safe. Because again, the words that keep you safe with fear as your guardian is just giving more space to fear to tell you fearful things so it can be your protector. But as we see so often in life, those who act as our protectors are the ones that knowingly or unknowingly keep us imprisoned. And so anytime something arises, and even if you don't feel safe or you feel afraid, what if the unsafety I'm feeling is inviting resolution towards unsafety? What if it's not that you're too unsafe to feel this? What if the unsafe parts are ready to be resolved? And you say, I allow anything regarding this feeling or memory or experience to be seen, remembered, and felt to bring to it its highest resolution. And then fear has nothing over you. Fear no longer has anyone to coerce or convince. Because like I said before, in the ocean of oneness, there is no one to be lonely and no thing to be lonely about. And when there's no one to be lonely and no thing to be lonely about, fear has no one to imprison. Fear has no one to rescue. Fear has no one to convince. The prison cell remains, but the prisoner has vanished. And that's when fear becomes courage. But you cultivate the ability to transform those vibrations from fear to courage by welcoming your experiences and not assuming that welcoming your experiences is going to make them worse, because the only thing that makes them worse is your tendency to avoid them. Feel that. Let's see what the next question is, and I love you all so much. And by the way, if you're asking yourself, are we going to regularly do these Q&A videos? We are. So this is going to be a regular thing. We bring out questions from the All Access community, where you yourself, if you'd like to submit your personal question for me to answer in one of these videos, I invite you to be a part of the All Access community. It's incredible. I'm a member myself. We all have such a great time, because we're at a time in history where so many of us are waking up, but it's helpful to have the guidance to wake up and grow up on every level. And it's helpful to have the type of guidance that is really geared for the empath, for the heart-centered being, for the energetically and emotionally and psychically sensitive being. We're on a different journey, and the work we're doing on All Access is incredibly deep. For those of you that are part of it, you know. And the planet is ready for new leadership. And we, those who are waking up and growing up at record speeds, are being initiated to become the new leaders of the world, whether in our families, our neighborhoods, our communities, businesses, on stage, or even just heart to heart as we pass each other on the streets. It's time for new leadership. And we, the awakening ones, are those leaders. It is you who I serve. Okay, next question. Let's see. I would be doing good most of my day, and then I see a number or a sentence, or I'll hear something that reminds me of my past. Then I feel my emotions go from 0 to 100 real quick. What's the best thing to do? How do I stop them? Well, again, if we're stopping our emotions, that means we're interrupting the resolution of transmutation. Emotions means your nervous system or your energy field is processing an emotional current, a wave of sensation. And that wave of sensation is completing its journey of being felt within you as it is brought into total resolution. As it is brought into total resolution, by feeling your way to freedom, the cellular memories empty out, and the vibration that you have released can now be reborn at its higher opposite frequency. Just like by processing fear, we make room for courage. By processing sadness, we make room for happiness. By processing guilt, we make room for worthiness, and so forth. So if your ego is saying, I was feeling 0 on the emotional scale, now I'm feeling 100, how do I stop that? And most cleverly, the ego says, what do I need to heal to stop this? But to stop it means we're not acknowledging or respecting the transmutation process, where a feeling that's set into motion, even if you felt fine the entire day and you smelled a candle and it reminded you of your grandmother who's deceased and you instantly were hit by a wall of grief and you go, I was doing so good. How do I get back there? That would be a way for us to overlook that scent of a candle was saying you were ready and prepared to process and release and resolve the grief that was stored already within you, that was just being brought up to your attention at the moment it was meant to be processed. So we're not here to stop our feelings. We're here to respect the healing power of them. And so if we say to ourselves, I allow this feeling that is being felt to be felt completely and to provide me the resolution it is meant to transform into. Just simple words like that. And then you're a part of the healing. Then you are the person who is either giving birth to a new you or experiencing the dying off of the old self. But you're moving with the current of reality. You're moving with harmony. You're moving in the direction of transformation, not trying to interrupt it. Because if you could stop the feeling, you'd put the memories back in your cells and you'd carry it with you for something else to trigger it in you. And of course, it's very normal to be in a place where we just want to get beyond all this stuff and not have to go through it ever again. But what would life be? In the beginning, it would feel different. It would feel like, oh, this is the way I've always wanted it to be. And then what would it feel like after that? It would eventually get boring. And then you'd start feeling the itch and the desire for an adventure. But the ego only imagines adventures on its terms and conditions because it's imagining from a space of control. So again, there's going to be a time where there's not so much to resolve. There will be a time where you are fully resolved. But when you're fully resolved, instead of those emotions arising inside your body, they're arising inside the bodies of the other people you're serving. And because you're an empathic being, you're going to feel other people's resolutions and process just as you felt your own resolutions and process in your body. So what's hilarious is, as an empath, I can tell you directly, I've gone through many years of tumultuous emotional healing, and I've healed that in myself. And yet I serve so many of you in the world where everything you feel in your body, I feel in my body. I walk around the world and I feel everyone's energy inside my body. Now, in the beginning, that was very overwhelming for me. But then I realized, who was it overwhelming to? It was overwhelming to my ego. And so as I explored oneness, which wasn't me looking for oneness, it was oneness just waking up inside of me. And as more and more of the imprinting of ego started to dissolve back into oneness, and there became no one to be lonely and no thing to be lonely about, my body just became a psychic instrument. And whether I was sensing an emotion in this body or some other body, it was one and the same. And so what's interesting is, when you heal yourself, you then are moved into greater service to help other people to heal. But what they're healing in their body, you feel in your body. The difference is, on either level, you don't carry it with you, because you only carry it with you if there's an ego for it to stick to. And so the reason we're all going through this awakening journey is because, by awakening, not only does it help you bring your own healing journey to states of resolution, but it allows you to be able to sense everyone else's experience without it overwhelming you or shutting you down. So it's all a part of an incredible process. And again, there are things that come up for me, healings, where I go, wow, I didn't know that was in there. But just my luck, I get to have a seat. And I get to hold space for the resolution of something incredible, which is exactly what I say to my own heart, just as I say it to yours. So thank you for that honor. Let's see. Let's see what else. I'm going to take a couple more questions. I'm flip-flopping between genuine self-worth and then, boom, self-sabotage. I want so desperately to create, to use my talents for the betterment of the world I can affect. I make great headway and then get stuck going backwards into only seeing my limitations, staying small, reminiscing of all the times of hurt and belittlement. When will I break this? I feel I have a hand extended to leave this loop. Why can't I stop sabotaging myself, when weirdly, simultaneously, I'm feeling so at peace? Well, it's because, when I sense the frequency of this question, the ego is dissolving at a very incredible rate and speed, but the patterns still remain. There's a very interesting stage of awakening where the ego has dissolved, right? The attachment, the ego, the grip that the ego has on itself has let go, but the patterns still remain, even with no ego present. It's very interesting. So I think the resolution of this, if I tune in intuitively, is that we don't have to get ourselves into a perfect state before we bring our talents to the world. So the resolution is going to be whether you think you're ready or you feel totally not ready, Bring your talents to the world just as you are. Allow yourself to be the most perfect or imperfect or perfectly imperfect expression of yourself, and just bring your talents to the world and find a place to express them. And if one door doesn't open, another one will. And that's what I did. Is there was a certain point in my journey where I used to work on myself and work on myself, and nope, I'm not quite ready to get on stage. Nope, I'm not quite ready. And what actually got me over myself, and this is just how I talk about myself, what got me over myself was remembering how much of the world is in a state of suffering. And if I am here to help alleviate suffering, then at a certain point, focusing my time and energy too much on myself and not being in a place to serve those who are needing to be served was counterintuitive to the mission at hand. So it'd be kind of like if you worked at a soup kitchen and your job was to feed hungry people, and you said, I can't open up the soup kitchen today because I just don't feel like I'm the most aligned in spirit. And the truth is, whether you feel aligned in spirit or not, there are people lining outside the soup kitchen waiting to be fed food. So we just need to feed people. We just need to serve people. And we have to remember that trying to be too much of a higher perfect version of yourself will make you less relatable to other people. So being perfectly imperfect will allow other people to see their light reflected in your presence. And being perfectly imperfect will allow more people to resonate with you. It's like when I started channeling these teachings 18 years ago, and then at a certain point, people wanted to not just know the wisdom that came through this vessel, but they wanted to know the person who's lived the journey, who became this vessel. And it's equally a service for me to share my personal story with you as it is to share my gifts. And so in this day and age, I think that what sabotage does is sabotage is trying to prove, see, you're not perfect enough to step into your gifts quite yet. You still have to work on yourself. And you have to allow yourself to stop working on yourself and spend more time working on putting your talents out into the world in order for the pattern to really dissolve. So if we're spending time pulling back from stepping out into the world and working on ourselves, we sometimes will sabotage ourselves just to pull ourselves back into working on ourselves, because the secondary gain of working on yourself is I'm convincing myself that I have more things to work on to hide from the rejection that I'm really afraid might be awaiting me in the world. And if you're someone who's going to bring your gifts to the world, at some level, you're going to be rejected. When I came out into the world, and I'm not just telling this because of my story, but as an aside, when I came into this industry as a spiritual teacher, I was saying things that people weren't saying. And I still do that. And so some people would look at me and go, I don't know about this guy. And we had to beg people to give me a chance to speak at a spiritual bookstore. We had to create our own events just to allow people to discover what I could offer. And I was rejected day in and day out every time I tried to put myself out there. The difference was I didn't take no for an answer. I just shifted. If one door didn't open, or if the door that I opened closed, I went to the next one. I went to the next one, and I made it my mission to share my gifts with the world. And over time, the world was invited to notice. So sometimes the setup is that you will start to put your gifts out into the world. And either when you are afraid of rejection or at the first sign of rejection, you will pull yourself back and go, I'm being rejected because I'm not the perfect version of myself. And you're going to go back into more compulsive inner work. Or you're going to put yourself out there and things start to open up. But then you're like, I don't sense the rejection. So it must be around the corner. And I don't want it to jump out and startle me. So I'm going to do something and sabotage myself. And then I'm going to say, why did I just sabotage myself? There surely must be more things to work on. Then I pull myself back and I work on myself more. And it's all designed to keep you from being rejected. But do you know what awakens the rock star in you? Surviving rejection. What makes you strong in your skin to hold space and shine your light and allow people to see the light of the universe that they are in your presence? See who you become in the aftermath of rejection. Dare to be rejected, pick yourself up, dust yourself off, and move forward as a greater version of self. And if it happens again, we say thank you. If it happens again, we say thank you. If it happens again, we say thank you. And we do not stop. We might take days to rest. We might take days to integrate. You might take a personal day. You might go to brunch with your friends. You might have some time where you sit and you drown in a pool of tears. And I've done it many times. And I've sat there wondering, does the world really want to hear what I have to say? Maybe I'm just fooling myself, thinking I'm a channel of the universe. And guess what? It all opens up if you stay the course. So you don't have to move quickly. Just mindfully. Because part of success, part of having the power to use your influence in a positive way, to give people back their power, not to manipulate or abuse it, occurs by daring to be rejected. And there's this very funny self-sabotage play where you will either act as the imperfect you at the moment a perfect opportunity arises, just to instigate the rejection that is there to make you into an even higher version of yourself. And if you don't know the setup, you're going to then take that moment of self-sabotage and pull yourself back. Say, I've got to lock myself in my house and work on myself more until I surely don't do that again. And you miss the perfection of the whole journey. There's a time to be in your house and work on yourself, and there's a time to come out and shine. And even if you find yourself self-sabotaging or you're in a moment talking to someone of influence and you put your foot in your mouth, well, one less time I'm going to do that. And if that leads to a moment of rejection, it was never meant to be a yes in the first place. One less rejection to overcome, one more rejection I've processed, surely I'm one step closer to the opportunity that allows me to shine. Will you say yes to that? And whether you're ready to say yes to it or not, I say yes to serving you. I say yes to loving you. I say yes to supporting you. I say yes to honoring you. What an incredible Q&A call this has been, the first of many. And what an honor it is to be a part of your journey, your healing, your awakening, your integration. Such an honor to know you. And thank you for receiving me. Until the next time we come together, I'm Matt Kahn, honoring you infinitely, bowing in your presence, and inviting you to shine brighter than ever before. It's your time to shine. The world is waiting. I love you. Namaste.